DNA synthesis for both of them, right? Interface is exactly the same. Mitosis, we have one cytokinesis. In meiosis, we had two cytokinesis events, right? One replication, two cell divisions for meiosis. Meiosis, you end up with four germ cells or gametes. Mitosis, two daughter cells, right? So four daughter cells versus two daughters. We didn't talk about this. Independent assortment is essentially what I was saying about pulling apart of homologous chromosomes, right? And it's a random whether all the blues go one way, all the reds, half the blues, half the reds, which half of the reds, which half of the blues. Okay? And so a gene that's on chromosome 1 that you got from grandma and a gene that's on chromosome 11 that you got from grandma don't have to go together. Right? They can go together or they can come apart. Grandma and grandpa can come together, grandma and grandma, grandpa and grandpa. They call that independent assortment of different genes. So that all the genes you got from one chromosome don't stay together in the gamete. Right? You get that random assortment. That's independent assortment. We're going to talk about that more in the next lecture, too. Okay. Happens technically when the spindle grabs them, which is more like during prophase, but we actually see them coming apart in anaphase, right? That's where they're pulled apart. So independent assortment, meiosis one. All right, we'll get to that. Okay. Yes. Okay, so we talked about that. Blah, blah, blah. We did a little bit of this. I'm not skipping it, but we've already talked about this, and we kind of need to go on. This is the example of sort of random or independent assortment, right? They could line up like this and pull apart this way, or they could line up like that and end up pulled apart like that, right? They're not showing you the middle steps, right? Dot, dot, dot between there. Because first we have to pull apart the homologs, then we pull apart the sisters. They're not, they're just giving us the end product. Don't let that freak you out. I think it's a bad figure, but I didn't write this textbook. But they're just showing you how they line up here at metaphase really matters. In this case, it'd be all the reds going one way, all the blues going the other way. This is what the gametes phenotypes would look like from those genes. If it lined up at metaphase this way, then these would be how those genes would sort. Right? So brown eyes and black hair don't always have to go together. We're assuming brown eyes was on this one and black hair was on that one. Right? They can show up together, but they don't have to. Right? Depends on how they've aligned and how they've assorted. Independent assortment. One gene does not control what assorts with another gene. Okay. Genetic diversity. Okay. Oh, so here was the, somebody asked me. So if we have this many distinct chromosomes and we can have either one go either way, there's 8.4 million different combinations of gametes just from meiosis one, just from that meiosis one. And then we add on top of it crossing over, and they tell us the math comes up to 64 trillion different possible offspring from two parents. So, how many people are on the planet now? 7 billion? Okay, so there's not going to be anybody like you on this planet. Unless you have an evil identical. Okay, so we're going to talk about gametogenesis because I lied to you guys already today and yesterday. Ooh, here's some parts you should be familiar with. Okay, so we're going to talk about oogenesis, the creation of eggs. This is the one that I totally lied about. I mean, I kind of told you a little bit at the beginning. So So I didn't lie about what happens to the chromosomes, but I did lie about what happens during meiosis to get to the end product. As it turns out, we only get one functional egg. So one fun gamete at the end of oogenesis. Okay. And that's because, remember that picture of the egg? The egg was gigantic and all the teeny little sperm on it? Because the egg needs to be in charge of all the protein, carbohydrates, fats, energy needed for that embryo to survive until implantation and hooking up with mom's vascular system. Okay, and that's a good 7 or 8 days from fertilization. So that zygote, which is the egg and sperm fusion, starts doing mitosis while it's traveling down the fallopian tubes, hoping to find the uterus and implant. But for 7 or 8 days, it's getting no oxygen, no extra energy. Everything has to be stored up in that egg. So the egg's huge. So we can't afford to make 4 huge eggs from each cell. It's just not feasible. So what happens is, from the beginning, right, we do exactly what we're supposed to do. But when we do that first meiosis one of them gets all the cytoplasm and the other one is just essentially the DNA in a membrane. Okay, so one functional cell after meiosis one. There's that other guy, we call it a polar body. It exists, it usually sits there. It gets reabsorbed at some point. Okay. This is where we arrest in utero. And we don't finish meiosis one until it's that egg cycle to be ovulated. So essentially, in utero, we go through G1S, G2, and we're getting ready to start into meiosis one, but we stop there. And so then all our eggs are just sitting around like that until it's their turn that month to be ovulated. Then they go through meiosis one. Upon ovulation, they don't go through meiosis two until they're fertilized. So we don't even waste the energy if there's no sperm available. Right? If there's no sperm around, it just gets washed out. Okay? If it gets fertilized, we go through meiosis two. But again, all the cytoplasm just goes to one of them, and the others are polar bodies. Just the DNA and just the membrane. And they end up being absorbed. Okay. So that we end up with one gigantic functional egg at the end. Yeah. It's unclear. So I think both have been seen. This one's drawn like, right, we don't see the first polar body going through its split. There is evidence that that one does go through its split also, and it doesn't do anything, but that it can. But they definitely see both of those polar, like in an IVF and in vitro fertilization, yeah, they've seen 3 or 2. So the cells usually do what they're supposed to do, but those are not functional. Right. Yep. No. So multiples are, so none of these would be functional, right? These guys are just totally non-functional. If a sperm happened to get in there, they have not enough energy to do anything, right? So that's the cell that needs to be fertilized with the sperm. They're showing these gigantic, just like this would be the egg, and then this would be the polar body. You know, in reality, they're teeny tiny, but they can't, you know, they're just trying to show you what they look like so you can count the chromosomes in them. But they're really tiny. They're the size of a sperm, essentially, or smaller, because they don't even have any of the other structures that the sperm has. So yeah, they just kind of sit there and do nothing, okay? And so there's one functional egg at the end. And it's a very expensive or energy, you know, rich deal. Okay, so we have one, you know, we get one a month. That's the energy we put into that one. Whereas spermatogenesis is, I didn't lie, right? It's cheap. It's cheap and easy, okay? Because they're not, they don't need to have this cell grow and collect all kinds of energy and store carbohydrates and fats and get gigantic. It's just DNA and a plasma membrane. There's usually one mitochondria somewhere at the base of the tail here because we need some energy for that swimming motion. But otherwise, that's all that that has. So spermatogenesis works just like we were talking about meiosis. Oogenesis, you really just end up with one functional egg. So it's asymmetric cytokinesis, right? The DNA does what it's supposed to, but instead of pinching down the middle, you know, it just pinches off the tiny little guy, right, and keeps everything else with the one.